Hello, I'm Hannah Gelbart, and this is What in the World from the BBC World Service. We know that our oceans and the creatures living in them are under threat from things like warming waters and pollution. Now, a huge cruise ship is about to be sunk on purpose to become the world's largest artificial reef. The people behind it say that it'll improve biodiversity, local tourism, and fishing. But are artificial reefs actually good for the environment, or even necessary? Here with me in the studio to break this down is Georgina Rannard, our climate and science reporter. Hello, welcome back to the podcast.
Thank you, Hannah. Good to be here.
So let's start off with this ship. It's called the SS United States, and it's absolutely massive. It's longer than the Titanic. It could carry over 3,000 passengers and crew, and it is now about to go down to the bottom of the ocean off the coast of Florida. So why is it being sunk?
The main reason they're doing that, well, there's two reasons. One is because they want to create this artificial reef. And what that means is it's about putting a man-made structure on the bottom of the sea, where the idea is that when they sink it, it creates this structure that fish, octopus, vertebrate, plants can all colonise, because they, like everyone else, like to have a home, and it will create a sort of natural environment for those things to live in. So one is to improve that marine environment for those species. But the other is really also about tourism. So the ship will be sunk in Florida, where it will join tens of other artificial reefs. And you can really imagine it. You go there on holiday and you find out there's this historic, beautiful ocean liner on the bottom of the sea there. And people may go out on glass-bottom boats. They may go diving or even snorkeling. And they would be able to see all of these species that have colonised this ship. And the idea is it would obviously attract those tourists, bring economic benefit to the area, and also perhaps encourage divers not to visit some of the other more natural reefs. So kind of moving that tourism away from more precious environments like real coral reefs.
What is the process going to involve in order to prepare this ship, this ocean liner, so that it becomes an artificial reef?
So it's quite a long process. From beginning to end, this one will take 1.5 years. That's because, as you can imagine, it's full of contaminated materials. It's got metal, plastics, oils, chemicals, and they want to clean those out, remove all that material, take away the paint. They then also have to begin the process of sinking the ship. And it is as simple, in the past anyway, as basically exploding the ship. So I looked into some of the previous ships, so aircraft carriers have been sunk there as well, and they basically load the bottom of the boat, which is underneath the water, with explosives, blow them up, and then all the water, of course, comes into the bottom and it sinks. That, for this ship, for the SS United States, will cost about $10 million.
Is there anything that people do to encourage wildlife, marine life, to come and colonise it and make a home out of it, or do they just let nature get on with it?
So, by and large, it's a natural process, so It varies on the location where you sink the ship or create the artificial reef. But it is as simple as you let the ship sink or whatever it is, and then naturally those species will begin to colonise. Some studies say that within 5 years you can have an increased number of fish, you can have coral and algae growing over all of those surfaces. So you can imagine those species moving inside and living inside the dining rooms or the cabins or growing along the railings of the ship. In some cases, they do try to encourage it. So there's a case in Mexico where they transplanted some coral onto the artificial reef with the idea that that would sort of kick off the process of species living there and taking root. But it is as simple as you're basically creating a new home for them. And over time, they'll sort of discover the area, and a biological cycle will establish. So if you have plants growing there, they will create nutrients. The fish may move there because there are more nutrients. And that creates a feedback cycle.
You mentioned that this particular ship is going to go through a very meticulous preparation process to remove some of the contaminants. Is there a risk that it still could be toxic or polluting to the environment? And what about, what if a ship sinks naturally? Could oil not leak out of it and damage the environment around it then?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a really good question. In the US, it appears to be quite a well-regulated industry. There are whole companies that are set up just for this process, to take a ship from essentially being written off. It no longer has a commercial use, and they take it from there to the point where it can be sunk. And that process appears to involve quite a lot of care. You know, they do decontaminate it, they take away those chemicals. But of course, there's always a risk that the job hasn't been done properly.
There are some people who are really unhappy about the fact that this ship is being sunk because, as you set it out, it's this incredible old piece of history, essentially. And some historians, not necessarily environmentalists, they would rather that it becomes a museum. Is making artificial reefs, do you think, just a way for humans to get rid of waste items, things like big old ships that are otherwise really difficult to get rid of?
See, I actually think that it's probably quite an inconvenient way of disposing of a ship because it's a very involved process. I said earlier that this one, the SS United States, will cost around $10 million to turn into an artificial reef. You've got all of the cost of the decontamination, but also a lot of those materials could have been sold off. You know, metal, scrap metal is very valuable now. But I think you're right that it's quite controversial in terms of, if you look at the pictures of it, it is kind of a stunning ship. It's a bit aged now and a bit decrepit. The company behind it would say, well, this is a way of preserving its legacy, and at least they say it will have some value on the seafloor.
Do you think that we still need to be putting more stuff on the bottom of the ocean? Do we not have enough stuff down there already?
So I think there is a lot of, like you said, there's a lot of stuff down there. There's around 3 million shipwrecks and similar wrecks on the seafloor. But the ocean is a vast part of our planet. There's, you know, it covers a huge area of the surface of the Earth. So I do think it's a question of us running out of space for these wrecks or even there being too many on the seafloor. I think the main question is this really the best way of trying to protect marine species who are at threat from global warming and pollution in the oceans? And so perhaps sinking these vast metal structures down to the seafloor isn't really the best way of trying to create environments. And I think lots of environmentalists would say we should be focusing on the environments we already have and protecting those rather than trying to create this mixture of a bit of tourism, diving, plus a place for these species to live.
And it's not just ships. I was reading about aeroplanes, even New York subway cars, lots of different things that have been sunk to create artificial reefs. One study found that artificial reefs cover 19 square kilometres, that's 7 square miles of the US seafloor. I mean, that's tiny compared to the size of the sea and the oceans. What works best when it comes to sinking things to make artificial reefs?
So I was quite surprised when I was looking into this at just how many there are.
Yeah.
In some countries, I think in Japan, they've been doing it for 400 years because by creating a new environment for species, they can attract fish and obviously then they can fish there. And in the US, it's been going on since the 70s. What some of the research says that you need to, is that you need to use materials that are good for the environment, they're safe, they're pH neutral, so you're not changing the chemistry of the ocean, you're not using contaminated materials. There was a case that where they sunk 3 million tyres in the 1970s with the idea, again, you would create this space for fish and octopus and everything else to live in. And that didn't work and it released a lot of toxins into the environment and they weren't anchored properly, so they moved and it damaged some of the coral in that area. So clearly it has to be done in the right way.
So what I'm hearing is that it's not just a case of people using the ocean as a way to get rid of things that they otherwise can't, big old clunky things like forms of transport. But that isn't the only type of artificial reef. Most artificial reefs are actually custom made, aren't they?
Yeah, so there are lots of different types, but one of the ones that I particularly like is one in Mexico in the Cancun Marine Park, which is called Musa. And that one was established because the founder said that he was concerned about the level of degradation and pollution on some of the natural coral reefs in that area. And he wanted to try and pull some of the visitors to those coral reefs to a different place. So he created, now there's 500 sculptures and they include sculptures of people, but also there's a Volkswagen car that's been sunk. And that is clearly, you know, it's a very deliberate project. They've made these structures and they're made of particular types of material that are considered beneficial or neutral to the environment. That one is one project, but it's also a practice that's used to protect seagrass meadows or coral reefs where they build, they look like these sort of cones and they've got holes in them so you can sort of imagine the species moving through them. And they're put in various places around the world, again, just to build these environments for these creatures to live in. Some of them are done in order to protect coastlines because from erosion or from huge amounts of sand that move in storms. And then the secondary effect is that it creates this reef for species to live in. So there are lots of different types.
So is there any evidence that these artificial reefs, whether they're these amazing statues that you've described or sunken ships, is there any evidence that they actually help the ocean and ocean creatures?
So we don't really know what the long-term impacts are. They're really difficult to study because we can't necessarily separate the different variables. We don't know if there are more fish because we sank the ship or if something else changed in the environment that meant there was a growth in seagrass or in the coral or in the mollusks. There are quite a lot of studies that show that in the short term you do have a bloom of life. So fish do move there, they colonise. That creates this nutrient cycle, for example, that generates plant growth and coral growth. But there are also examples where non-native species can colonise that area because it's obviously not a natural environment. Mm. So it might attract invasive species, invasive fish, and that obviously has a knock-on effect on the environment. I did read about one example, which is seagrass meadows, which are a type of flowering plant. They're really important. They soak up carbon and they're very helpful in sort of cleaning the ocean environment, but they're threatened because there's a 7% decline every year. And one study showed that after building an artificial reef, the seagrass, a lot of it colonised that area and then fish came. But they weren't also sure about how long those effects would last for. There was another case in Puerto Rico where a concrete reef was created to protect the coastline. And in the short term, there was a growth in fish and in coral, but there was also a bloom in seaweed because of this imbalance in nutrients. There was too much oxygen and therefore there was excessive nutrients, and that led to some of the coral to die. So it's still a bit of an open question. Naturally, if you put a giant home for species to live in, they're probably going to move there. But we don't know in the long term what that means if they're going to live for a long time. And there's also concerns that moves them away from more natural environments where you have a sort of a proper functioning ecology, and you may be disrupting that by placing these artificial structures there.
Although, as you say, it also moves the tourists away, and that could, in the longer term, help some of these corals that might be a little bit over-visited.
Absolutely. I think that's one of the main reasons that people want to do it. It's the idea that if you've got this one beautiful coral reef and everyone's going there, why not try and divert them almost by creating a different environment? But I think in the long term, you can't replace coral reefs with artificial reefs. That's not how the environment works. And so you need to maintain both. You may want to focus on those as a diversion for tourists, but I think a lot of environmentalists would say we still need to protect our coral reefs and make sure that they're not going to die out with increased pollution and ocean warming.
Georgina, thank you so much for coming into the studio.
Thanks, Hannah.
And thank you for joining us. This is What in the World from the BBC World Service. I'm Hannah Gelbart, and we'll be back with another episode soon. See you then.